In this part of lecture, we talk about the understanding the lean SVM support vector machines. During training, SVMs learn how important each of the training data points is to represent a decision boundary between two classes. Typically, subset of training points matter for defining the decision boundary. Only a few points they matter for the for defining the decision boundary. These are the points that lie on the border between two classes. These decision points, these important points, they lie on the border of two classes. So if we can identify those two points, then we can mark the we can design a better support vector machine, a support vector classifier. These are called as support vectors that lie on the boundary of the classes. So therefore, with this intuition, this method is called as support vector machines. To make a prediction for a new point, the distance from each of the support vector is measured. A classification decision is made based on distance to the support vector and the importance of support vectors that was learned during training. The classification decision is based on the distance of distance from the support vector. We made the classification on that. And the importance of support vector, how much importance for each support vector is. The points that are vectors that are close to the decision boundary, we give them less importance. They are ambiguous points. The distance between data points is measured by Gaussian Kernel. So this is the expression by which the distance is measured, where x1, x2 are data points. Data points that denotes the distance, and gamma is a parameter that controls the width of the Gaussian kernel. How much is the width of Gaussian kernel? Figure below shows that the result of training a support vector machine on two-dimensional, two-class dataset. The decision boundary is shown in black, and support vectors are shown as a wide outline. So I run this piece of code and show how it looks like. So this is the decision boundary, and these two are the support vectors. Because we made the decision, we made the boundary based on these points. So these are the support vectors which are close to the decision boundary, and they are given the more importance. So more importance will be, we are confident of these points, but we are less confident about this point because it is closer to the decision boundary. Further from the decision boundary, they are more important. More importance is given to them. In this case, the SVM yields a very smooth and non-linear boundary. You can see that the boundary is non-linear. So we can adjust the parameters C and gamma, and we can see that how the different effects are on the decision boundary when we change the hyperparameters C and the gamma. So tuning the SVM parameters, gamma parameter is shown in the formula above. So this gamma parameter, we have shown this gamma parameter, and we change this parameter. It controls the width of the Gaussian kernel. How much is the width of the Gaussian kernel? And it determines the scale of what it means for points to be closed. So when the points are close together, what does it mean? The C parameter is a regularization parameter, similar to that used in the linear model. It limits the importance of each point, how much importance should be given to each point using the C parameter. I run this piece of code, and it displays the figure plot for a different value of gamma and different value of C. So as you can see that as we move from left to right, the value of C is increasing. The initial value of C, the value of gamma is increasing. The value of C is 0.1. Gamma is varying from 0.1, one and then 10. And you can see that this is boundaries look like this way. When C is equal to 0.1, gamma is 0.1. When we change the gamma to 1, the boundary looks like this way. And when change the gamma to 10, the boundary is like this way. So the boundary shrinks when we increase the value of gamma. So downward, we increase the value of C. Initially, C is 0.1, then 1, and then it goes to 100. C is 0.1, 1, and then 100, and we see that when this value of c is 0.1, the line is almost linear. Then c is equal to 1, then line is going to bend. And when c is equal to 1000, it gives more importance to these outlier points. So this is the outlier. When c is equal to 0.1, it is giving less importance to these points, but gradually when we increase the value of c, the importance is given to c, to these points. So going from left to right, we increase the value of gamma from 0.1 to 10, so left to right. A small gamma means a larger radius. Small gamma means larger radius. A radius is large, but as gamma is increased, the radius of the decision boundary is getting small. This is reflected in very smooth decision boundary. When c is small, when gamma is low, the decision boundary is very smooth and it is a low complexity. But when we increase the value of gamma, the complexity, the decision boundary is abrupt and the classifier is getting complex. A low value of gamma means the decision boundary will vary slow. Decision boundary will vary slow and yields a model of low complexity, while higher value of gamma yields a more complex model like this. So going from top to bottom, we increase the value of C from 0.1 to 1000. As with the linear models, a small C means a restricted model and where each data point can only have very limited influence. You can see that at the top left, the decision boundary looks linear. Top left, the decision boundary is linear, with the misclassified points barely having an influence on the line. Misclassified has no importance or no influence on the decision boundary. But here we gradually give the influence. This point is giving the influence, making an influence on the decision boundary. Increasing C as shown in figure, the bottom right allows the points to be a stronger influence on the model and makes the decision boundary bend, correctly classify them. Decision boundary is getting bent to correctly classify them. So then we set the C is equal to 1 and gamma is equal to 1 over features, and then we run it and see that the training set performance is 90%, but test set performance is 94%. Here we get another problem that the SVM is very sensitive to the hyperparameters, the tuning of the parameters and the scaling of the data. So what we do next is that we rescale the data from -1 to 1. So here, this is the plot of the data. So it goes from 0 to 30 and 0 minus 10 is by minus 3 to 10 is by plus 3 or so. So then what we do is common rescaling method. We do it for the breast cancer data set. And what we are going to do is that we are going to scale the data, and scaling is making it from 0 to 1. So here we run this piece of code, and what it does, it scales the data from 0 to 1. So all the features are from 0 to 1, and then we run our experiment and see that now the performance is better, and now the training set goes to 98% and test set goes to 97%. So after that, what we do is that now we tune the parameters of the C. So scaling data has a huge difference. Now we have training and testing performance are quite close to 100%. Now we can change the value of gamma or C, and then we see that how it works. So when we change the value of gamma and C, and now the performance is much more better. Training set 99% and test set is 97.6%. Previously, it was training set was 98% and test set was 97.2%. But now it has raised to 97.9%. So these are the things about the support vector machine or kernelized support vector machine. Now what we talk is strengths and weaknesses of the parameters. Kernelized support vector machines are powerful tools and perform very well on a variety of data sets. SVMs allow the complex decision boundaries even if the data has only a few features. They work very well on low dimensional or high dimensional data sets. But running SVM up to a samples of 1000 samples is okay, but if the samples number of samples are more than 100,000, then it is more time taking and memory usage requires. Another downside of the SVM is that they require careful pre-processing of the data. For example, tuning of the parameters and the scaling of the data. So these are the issues that we have to overcome. Further, SVM models are hard to inspect that we can't, it is difficult to explain to the non-expert people that why if we tune the parameter or why the performance gets increased. So this is the other limitation of this work. Still, it might be worthy trying SVM, particularly if all of your feature representation measurements in similar units, if all the measurements are in similar units, for example, the pixel intensities in the case of images, so it is a good option. Important parameter in kernel SVMs are the regularization parameters, that is C, how we choose the C, the choice of kernel-specific parameters, and other primarily focused on RPF kernels are available in scikit-learn. So the main thing is the careful selection of the gamma and the C. So it makes the model very good. So therefore, good settings of the two parameters are usually strongly correlated, and gamma and C should be adjusted together. So here it was all about the SVM and kernelized SVM. Here is the task that you can apply the SVM and SVC to classify iris classification. So this is the task that you will do by yourself, and these are the resources that are mentioned over. Thank you very much. So it was all about the kernelized support vector machine.